So I'm gonna set up Fred, and then Fred's gonna set up me. That's what we're gonna arrange this. And what we're doing in response to Jerry's request is we're bringing together the examples which are necessary to gain insight or, you know, personal experience in respect to the footnote in Lynn's recent document, Science or Fantasy, in which, as you remember, he references the relationship between the Opus 111 Sonata by Beethoven, which I think was written about 1821, if I'm not mistaken.
21 and 22, yeah.
Yeah.
Started on 1819, but that's the main.
Right, about 1821. The relationship of that to Mozart's 475, the Fantasy in C minor. But also then brings in the question of Empson's conception of ambiguity and Luca Boccherini's conception of the bird aviary. So just to sort of set the right tone for being able to think about this, we will start by hearing, if I hit the right button, the Boccherini, which I'm sure is not familiar to people. I'm sure Nancy and Dave will be shocked thinking, is this Mozart's piano quartet in D? But it's not, it's Boccherini's quintet. We're called the Birds. There's a little introduction. It was an imitation of King Carlos's aviary, which he was very, very proud of. So he wrote this this little quintet. He wrote 125 quintets for two cellos over a long period of time. And Lynn has often emphasized his affection for Boccherini, but it came from hearing this. It's funny because, you know, Aristotle says that music. This is sort of funny to think about, because Aristotle says that music comes from imitating nature, which is obviously completely bunk and totally insane. So the question is, why does this strike Lynn as being on a higher level than that kind of idea? Lynn also will polemicize greatly against what's called program music. But I think it really draws, I think the reason he references it here, because I've been thinking about it a lot, because it's just sort of a funny pointer that he's often mentioned, is because it draws attention to this question of the power and ambiguity of the trill. And you really can't grasp what Beethoven is looking at unless you locate yourself in a certain, what Beethoven is doing, unless you locate yourself in a certain domain in which this question of ambiguity, higher orders of ambiguity is constantly coming in. So it kind of provokes you to think about the trill in a different way. And I actually asked people to notice that after that little introduction, the transition between the introduction and the aviary is itself a trill. And then the trill is transformed into the bird call. So it's not just, he's provoking you to think about this in a certain way, this focus on this question of ambiguity. And obviously Lynn is being very provocative, because what he's doing is he's saying music, science, and economics are all one thing. That there is no difference between music, science, and economics. And that in order to effect the kind of transformation of culture that we have to bring about at this very turbulent moment of history, this has to be very clear to us. This is not something that we can just say. It's something that we have to know in order to be able to most effectively unleash this, because at a certain critical point, this is what's going to determine our ability to defeat the oligarchy. Is this underlying, absolutely, truly human culture for which Beethoven was definitely a prophet? You know, Lynn uses this term prophet in the beginning of the Delusion paper. He says certain people are prophets. Why are they prophets? They stand outside the degeneracy, the axioms, the fixed notions of their moment of history. They are outside looking upon this and actually conceptualizing where humanity has to go. And there's absolutely no question that Beethoven, in these later compositions, actually achieved this kind of pinnacle of achievement, this kind of compositional method, where he planted a kind of ticking time bomb in civilization, which was highly articulated corpus of works in which this capacity within the human population could be brought out. And it's clearer than in any other composition. It's rooted in Bach. It's rooted in his reflections on the way Mozart looked at Bach. There are works by Bach, like certain sections of the Goldberg variations, where Bach is getting at the same thing. But there's no corpus of works which, with such elaboration, actually walks the human person, the individual, and the society through the method of thinking which actually allows for a truly human society, which is the foundation for a sane economic policy. So this stuff is really important. It is really, really important. And in groping for ways of being able to articulate verbally the ideas, because it's not really intended to be completely explained in words. I mean, that's never the intention in music. It's the music which has the ideas. But people, you know, Lynn is bombarded all the time with the question, what do you mean by musical ideas? Where do I find the idea? How do I know it's the idea? How do I know I have the right idea? The youth keep asking him that. You know, people have been asking him that for 25 years. You know, what do you mean by a musical idea? And at a certain point, he did say in the past, I have a document that I'm very fond of, where he said, you really cannot get at this without a notion of Platonic ideas in general, that a musical idea is a Platonic idea. More recently, to put some flesh on that formulation, what Fred and Mindy and I worked through the other night in looking at the 111, is the way that in the 111, Beethoven really achieved this incredible unity between a Keplerian view of harmonics and a Leibnizian notion of the monad, which I think, as things stand for myself and the discussion we were having, I think you're talking about Riemannian phase spaces. You're talking about a Riemannian conception of development. That's what you're looking at. But what does that mean? I mean, you know, we've had lots of classes on Riemann. Everybody has their own idea about what that means. But I, the guts of that, the way I, at this point in my own investigations of this, and this is, and you know, as I said, I ran this by Mindy and discussing this, Fred, I discussed it a little bit with John, who's, you know, off doing this rather than talking about it. You know, the, it becomes clearer and clearer in my mind that what you're dealing with is these Keplerian harmonics that the youth have been working on. And at the same time, this notion of the monad in music, which was referenced when Norbert Breinin was talking about Motivführung. You know, this conception of Motivführung, which is completely Leibnizian. And here, and you'll see in the 111, these two dimensionalities, or two dimensionalities of a Riemannian phase space are actually shown to be unitable, that they can be made into a one. This becomes clearer if you look at the succession of compositions which define what is called Beethoven's late period. One of the reasons that this is becoming clear is that some years ago, Lynn made this comment, which whacked all of us, which was based on a discussion that he had with Norbert Breinin, that the late period begins with the Seventh Symphony. And that seemed to me extremely odd. I mean, I don't know if people have a big opinion about the Seventh Symphony. I mean, everybody's heard it, and you know, it's one of these things that you know you may have really loved, and the second movement is totally enthralling. It totally grabs you, and so forth. But you wouldn't necessarily think of it as Beethoven's late period. I mean, in fact, it's Opus 92, and over the years, I mean, I sort of speculated because you know people tend to say the late period starts with Opus 101. That's, you know, the piano sonata 101 or the cello sonata 102, you know, and but this is Opus 92. And actually, I'll go quickly through the, just a schema very quickly of Beethoven's biography to show you where this is located in his life. But it would, the Seventh Symphony would locate the beginning of his late period much earlier than people tend to think, when people tend to think of still being in his middle period. And these designations in Beethoven's case actually do have real content. They're not just musical logical, you know, there's such an exorbitant ton of musical logical fairy tales and spin and Disney World that, you know, you have to be careful about almost anything that you verbally attribute to this, but this has a certain validity. But you would think that, you know, you would tend to think of this as being in that middle period. I don't know if people are familiar at all with the string quartets. It's an Opus 95. I sort of, in a very bold moment of thought, said, oh, the Opus 95 is the beginning of the late period. I don't know if people are familiar with it. It goes, you know, like that. It has this really, it's in C minor, this really aggressive, downward moving opening, and it has a lot of strenuous cross-voice relations. So you say, oh, that's the beginning of the late period. But this is the Opus 95, and it starts out in a very elegant and beautiful way, with a very appealing opening. Okay. I'm not going to, yeah.
In Schiff's lectures, what he has, I remember Schiff has this quote about, I guess it was the late period where he was talking about piano sonatas. Do you remember?
Right.
He's talking
about starting with Opus 101 when you're talking about the piano sonatas.
Yeah, he had a quote from Beethoven about how he was going to transform the sonatas or something like that.
Right. Yeah, I don't remember the exact quote, it's a little bit clearer if you just take the piano sonatas out of all the other writings. Basically, the way this thing worked is, I mean, I think the best way to get a handle on this is sort of the mental image I have. At 1803, Beethoven wrote the C minor piano concerto. And a friend of his, who was a top-level Prussian military dignitary, Prince Louis Ferdinand, did I have it right, David? It's Louis Ferdinand, right? Visits him and came to Vienna and visited him and heard this. And this man was an extraordinary pianist. And he actually ended up dedicating it to his friend Louis Ferdinand, who heard it, loved it, played it, and it was kind of, you know, bonded their friendship. In 1805, Friedrich Schiller died, or 1805. 05, yeah. And actually, in 1804, according to one account I read, I've never heard Helga talk about this, I've always meant to ask about this, but Schiller contemplated moving to Berlin, which was becoming increasingly the center of the resistance to Napoleon. And the question was, were the Prussians going to be able to stop Napoleon? And Schiller actually contemplated moving there, but then he died in 1805. And when he died in Vienna, where Beethoven was, there was actually broke out a very big fight in the theater environment, in the theater community, about staging Schiller's plays for the very first time. They had never been staged. And Beethoven was part of the team that fought for Schiller's plays to be staged. And they won. They won the fight. There were plays that were put on. And then this idea came up of doing some operas. And he was really gunning to set Joan of Arc and to set Wilhelm Tell. And after hearing Fidelio, they all said, oh no, forget it. You know, we let this guy, you know, start setting Schiller's operas. We're all sunk. We're going to be really in trouble. You know, or Christ on the Mount of Olives. I mean, it wasn't exactly what the oligarchy was looking for. He had some friends, of course. Beethoven had his own circle of friends, but he was having trouble getting sponsorship for this. But then in 1806, there's the Battle of Jena-Auerstadt, which is this absolutely devastating defeat for Prussia, and Louis Ferdinand is killed in the Battle of Jena-Auerstadt. And to me, this kind of exemplifies, in a sense, the world that Beethoven lived in, because this man was actually very dear to him, and he was one of the officers who died there.
He's quite a good musician. I've heard some of his compositions. They're actually quite good.
Yeah. It sort of exemplifies to me the world that he was living in, because many of the biographies that you read of Beethoven will go on endlessly about the thing with his nephew and about who was the immortal beloved, and these things almost don't even figure in, when in fact, obviously, this was far more significant to him than personal matters, which he was more than able to deal with, obviously. I mean, he dealt with his own frustration and rage about going deaf, you know. I mean, he was obviously a very Promethean personality. And you can imagine the ordering principle of the way his mind worked. And that's the point where he starts working on the Seventh Symphony. He's wrapping up the Sixth Symphony, which I think is, I told Lynn, I think it's very much about these Schiller plays, because either Wilhelm Tell or Joan of Arc would be perfectly accompanied by the Sixth Symphony. You know, if you remember, if you've listened to it, it's kind of uncanny. That's my personal view. But He started working on the Seventh Symphony in this period. And it is, Norbert Brunning was right, it is a compositional revolution, which is exemplified by two things. Number one, this incredible condensation. It's very short. It's only about 28 minutes. Most Beethoven symphonies are much longer than that. It's actually very compact, highly, highly organized, highly condensed. And it's based on a Bachian notion of inversion. It's just up and down like this, just like a Bachian notion of inversion. And the opening is this breakthrough, which is the four pairs of two intervals each, which then becomes the Brahms Fourth Symphony, and which also became something that was very important to Schubert in his Ninth Symphony. And next week, because we have to do this in two sessions, because we also there's a sort of a postlude to what Fred is going to do. But I'm just saying that next week what I'll do is I'll bring my cello and I can just play the opening theme of the Seventh Symphony, which is nice to play on the cello because it actually is an inversion of the Opus 69 cello sonata. The opening theme of the Seventh Symphony, Seventh Symphony is an inversion of the opening theme of the Opus 69 cello sonata. So it's nice to play the, even though it's done by woodwinds, it's nice to play the opening theme on the cello. So that's sort of where it fits in with Beethoven's life. And what he very consciously embarked upon was creating the kind of breakthrough in musical composition, which he knew was aimed at addressing in the most profound way the axiomatic crisis in civilization based on the way people thought. I mean, he was making an intervention to totally transform the method of mental life. And it's just, remember, everybody knows he was very close to Schiller. You know, Schiller says in the last of the aesthetic letters, I'm just trying to read them backwards to make sure I could get to the end, but he says at the end of the very last aesthetic letter, it's only the aesthetical state through which a society can actually be realized in which the will of the totality, the will of the community or of the whole, is perfected by the nature of the individual. If it has been economic need, physical need, which required that men enter into association, and if it has been reason, which planted in him social principles, it is only through beauty through which he can be it can be imparted to the individual to have a socialized personality. And then he says it is taste alone which can bring which implants harmony within the society, because it implants it within the individual. This terrible word taste, which really means intention, or the shared intentions of the society, or you know, these shared assumptions. Beethoven knew that he had to, I mean, this is sort of from his own period of time to think of it. I mean, Lynn would say this very differently, although people know what Schiller is getting at. But Beethoven is looking at this question of creating this kind of upheaval in the way people order their mental processes, because he knows that that's really what's at root with the crisis in civilization, and to give people this this connection to beauty, and to do it on the basis of concretizing this kind of Riemannian hypergeometry, which is based on this bringing together of the Keplerian harmonics, the concept of monad, and per Lynn's memo, a real notion of irony at the same time, which is the other element that you have to have to know the 111, irony. That's why it brings up Empson's seven types of ambiguity. In that connection, the last thing I'm going to say about this, I'm really setting you up, Fred. The last thing I'm going to say about this is the key in comprehending this this Bach-Beethoven thread, with Mozart there, but particularly Bach's omnipresent role in this, long after his death, I mean, he's hovering over everything, is the difference between a Keplerian notion of interval or Keplerian harmonics versus Galileo. This is the key. I mean, in other words, they're operating from the standpoint of the Keplerian notion of harmonics, which is that the entire universe, including your mind, whether you know it or not, is organized in a harmonically lawful way, in a way that is that is coherent with the entire universe. For Galileo, a musical interval was two objects banging up against each other, sometimes in a pleasant way and sometimes in an unpleasant way. And it's all very strange and really horrible and mechanical, but has been the stuff of musical conservatory classes for 400 years, right?
Yeah, you don't know who he's banging.
You don't know who he's banging, right, exactly. So
is he in the bathroom stall?
He's in the bathroom stall, the guy in the bathroom stall, right. So
with a telescope.
Sorry, because the undercover cop who got a lot of kicks out of this.
Yeah, exactly. So, but, you know, it is this Bachian notion. So with all of that in mind, we now turn to Fred and the 111.
Okay. Well, he writes the last three piano sonatas at the same time. He's working on them all together. But to me, the 111 is really, he saved the best for last. And he starts writing around 1819, but it's really the work is done 1821 to 22. So this is quite late. I mean, Rene just went through the Napoleonic Wars and the effect that that had. By this time, you have the Congress of Vienna in 1815. And 1819 starts the series of Carlsbad decrees, which turned Austria into a police state. And by the way, the Mount of Olives was banned.
Oh, okay.
Mount of Olives was banned. Many of Schiller's plays were banned. All kinds of works were banned. And, you know, under these conditions, people became what Lynn called lapsed classicists. They began to like Rossini. They began to like waltzes. They couldn't remember what they'd seen in Beethoven or Schiller. There was a willful dumbing, people dumbed themselves down like they do under Bush in the United States today. And you can only do one of two things under those circumstances. You can dumb yourself down, or you can decide to stand outside the society. And Rene was saying, that Lynn was saying, it's the prophets are the ones who actually stand outside the tragedy of the culture around them. As Lynn does, and I think Jerry's referred to the late Lynn, I think, which is appropriate.
Matisse is doing right now. Because Beethoven's decision is that he's going to push music ahead further than anybody even had a right to expect him to do. That really is his life period. He's not just making progress, he's doing things that we're not calling for, above and beyond the call of duty, so to speak. And he wants to give a gift to humanity because he's trying to make his own creative method more transparent. He and Kepler are unique in that way, in that they actually make the way in which they discover it more transparent. But it's also, it just has an ability to move people so that you feel more human. And it's had a profound effect. I remember once reading Lopez Portillo writing that that as a child, he read Goethe and listened to Beethoven until he cried. And that this had an effect on him being able to stand up and do what he did. And I remember Lynn's response to that. I think it was in the first Club of Life meeting. He said, how many statesmen, how many leaders in this world have actually drawn strength from Beethoven? And he said himself, without Beethoven, I don't think I would have made it. So that is the late Beethoven. And he knew he was doing it for the future, because even with the Opus 59 Razumovsky quartets, the composer Clementi came up to him and said, surely you're joking, you don't call this music. And Beethoven's response is, this is for future generations, not for you, Clementi. it's really amazing. Now, as Jeff said the other day, you don't start out without knowing where you're going. And Opus 111 ends up with one of the most sublime developments in all of music, which Lynn referred to as the Imperial, and we will definitely take a look at that. But it starts out in the first movement with a rather titanic struggle, and I use titanic for a reason, I'll get to that. And the opening is a shocking opening. However, part of the problem that we have today is we're not shocked because, first of all, we're not in a musically literate culture, so people really don't know what to expect, and it's hard for a composer to play with your expectations when you don't have any. But also, we have been accustomed, we've heard Wagner, we've heard atonal music, we've heard movie music, all kinds of irrationality.
This piece is called the Boogie Boogie piece by a lot of musicians.
The Third Grade Variation, yeah. People say, oh, that's a precursor of jazz and boogie woogie. But you hear all this stuff, and you hear all kinds of unlawful dissonances, so that there was one critic of Wagner who said, finally the mind, all these chromatic alterations, finally the mind just gives up and accepts whatever is going to come down the road, So it is a shocking opening, but I have to use a little pedagogy to actually give you an idea, okay? And I cannot play Opus 111, and I'm only going to try a couple sections of it here just so that I can work through. We'll listen to the real pianist do it, okay? Oh, I'm sorry, it's the wrong piece. Perspective a little bit. Now, listen to this. Musical often, right? After that's over, I want everybody to sing for me the note that seems like the center of the piece. Don't worry about the definition, just sing it. We're not getting in here. Try it again. Okay. Now everybody's singing the same note. Do you know what note you're singing?
C.
You're singing C. And this is in C minor. So you're singing what is called the tonic. And
did
I used
tune,
to...
Did you tune it down, right?
Pardon?
Did you tune it down when you turned it on?
No. No.
Okay.
I don't know how to turn it on.
While
well,
you're talking, I'll
well,
go ahead, keep talking.
Okay. I used to think of tonic as one of these stupid definitions. And you run into this, because frankly, from Lynn, the most important discoveries I've made in music are not the most profound analysis. It's rethinking the most simple definitions that you think you know. Because even Schiff, who is great, who's working with this, refers to the tonic as home. And in this piece, he said, you're coming home like your own bed where you can sleep in it. And that's not what it is. I just think of a point of perspective in a painting, which is what brings everything together. It's all organized around that. It actually comes from tonos, the Greek, for tone. And diatonic, a diatonic scale that begins and ends on the same note, means through the tone. So you have a tone that is a point of perspective. In painting you have, this is linear perspective, not Leonardo, but in painting you also have distance points, so you change keys. But without that, you have chaos. And I'm saying this because with atonal music, when you go atonal like Schoenberg does, it is absolutely impossible to have a sense of the one and the many. You can't have a unified piece without tonal relationships. In any atonal piece, the only relationship is to what comes immediately after and what came immediately before, because there's no unifying principle. Okay? This also has a theme, so to speak. You could all probably sing it, right? Try it. So you both identify the tone and you can sing, right? Please tell me what is the organizing tone here. I'm sorry. There's Do. Is that it? There isn't one. There isn't one. Beethoven is starting on what is called a double Lydian. And one of the things about the Lydian that is important to understand, if you take, say, an octave of C, as people know, that interval's a fifth, but that interval's a fourth, right? People know that? So there's two different, if you invert it, you get a different interval. The Lydian interval is unique in that it divides the octave in half, so that F sharp is the Lydian of C. What's the Lydian of F sharp? C. So you actually don't know which is the Lydian of which. It's a perfect ambiguity. And ambiguities take the form that they're very specific. It's not something that's just floating around. And with this, with what he has right there, F sharp, A, C, E flat, you'd have one Lydian here and another here, and then they're all separated by minor thirds. So it's a unique thing that completely is between all the keys. All the keys, all right? However, but the first interval, which is E flat to F sharp, does that sound familiar to anybody? It's the second voice. So what is Beethoven doing? He's taking the musical offering and the Mozart fantasy, and he's saying, let's look at this from the standpoint, as Mindy put it, of isolating the singularity. He's not looking at the theme, he's not looking at the key. He's doing it without any key, without any theme, so to speak. He's doing it from the entire Keplerian domain, as Rene was talking about. He's starting from the well-tempered system as a whole, and only later is he going to zero in on a theme and a key. Right? Now, why is he doing this? Well, partially, he wants to make his own creative method accessible to people, like the opening of the fourth movement of the Ninth Symphony. That's one of the greatest cases where somebody actually composed into the music their own search they're going for. I mean, when we go through the Hammerklavier, you'll see the opening of the fourth movement of the Hammerklavier, which he was working on at the same time of the ninth, is very similar to the opening of the fourth movement of the ninth. Do people know what I'm talking about with the ninth?
No.
Yeah, the cello.
You know how the cellos and the double basses have this recitative, ba-bum, ba-ba-da-da-dum, bum.
Right.
And Beethoven reviews each theme. He does the first movement, then cuts it off with the cellos. And then the scherzo and cuts it off. He does all three movements and cuts it off. But in the sketchbook, there's words underneath that. In the sketchbooks, he's saying, oh no, not these sounds. I must seek for something more joyful. That's too happy, that won't do. This is too sweet. And then finally, on the part that goes dum ba da 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 dum dum, that's out of tune, but he writes, aha, at last I found it, my Schöner Gutterfunken. So he's composing outside of the music, you know, the method of actually discovering a higher hypothesis. And that's what he's doing here. But at the same time, it's also a polemic, because if you think about the Sarpi method, they say, okay, we'll tolerate science, but we will take the discovery out of it, and we will just leave a formula. So people begin to get fixed. All the theory, you know, Rameau in 72 writes his harmony, Fuchs in 1725 writes counterpoint. So all that stuff has already been destroyed. Sonata form, you've heard this stuff about exposition, a development section, first subject, second subject, recapitulation. That's all written by Rijke, Marx, and Czerny after the music's composed. So the composers were not thinking in those terms. They didn't even know the term, you know, recapitulation, development, et cetera, et cetera. So everything's being done where people get fixated. And even though, you know, you start out with a theme and a good composer throws it out as a question and there's ironies and metaphor and you through development, you begin to get an idea of where it's coming from. Beethoven's actually saying, let's reverse the whole process. Let's actually start from the entire Keplerian domain. Let's not start from a planet. We don't determine anything about a planet from the planet itself. We determine about the planet from the entire solar system and the harmonics that order it. So he's looking at this from that standpoint, and only later will he choose a particular key and a particular so-called theme. Just like us, you know, we're not Australians or Canadians, we're universal, we're world historical human beings who deploy in a particular place because of what we're doing in the world, you know? So that's his start. However, his investigation of this Keplerian domain is not some soup. He's looking at it from the standpoint of Bach and Mozart's work, but in a certain way, he wants to make it clear. To me, I think of Riemann, when Riemann says, no axiomatic assumptions, only discoveries of principle. That's what he's looking at. He's looking at what are the discoveries of principle of Bach and then Mozart upon Bach. Because even Mozart, clearly references the Bach. But if you just take the interval, saying, let's look at that singularity of the Lydian interval, or the double Lydian as defined by this diminished seventh interval, and look at that, but not as an isolated interval in itself, but as Rene was saying, a monad located within the entire Keplerian system. Now, there's one other aspect of these double Lydians, which is that there's only three of them. If you do one on this diminished seventh interval from A flat to B, and then you do another one on this diminished interval from D flat to E,
that's it.
You got all 12 tones. You got all 12 tones of the well-tempered system. If you try going up the piano, in half steps, by the time you get to the fourth one, you're repeating the notes. You're repeating the notes. So there's only three of them. So this is an ordering of all 12 tones, not by the circle of fifths, not as a chromatic scale, as a descending scale, but according to the Lydian intervals, which is the literal, the interval of vocal registration. Because if people remember, all the register breaks in the human voice are separated by Lydian intervals. What is the sec, where does the set tenor enter the second register? Remember?
F sharp.
Oh,
C. Where does it enter the third register? F sharp. Where does the soprano enter the second register? F sharp. The third register on F sharp and the fourth on high C. But then the baritone, but then if you take it going down, they come down on B and F, back into the first and lower registers. You take all six voice species, every one of them has the linear intervals as the organizing principle, and if you take the up and down, you get all 12 tones. So this is actually, this actually is the interval of human vocal registration, but it also is beautiful because it has this particular ambiguity. So let's see what Beethoven does. The first one is E flat to F sharp. The next one is. A flat to B. And then the third one. D flat to E. E natural, I'm sorry. So this can't be accidental. Yeah, the piece is so powerful, people think, well, this is Beethoven, you know, he's really letting it loose here. But this cannot be accidental that he's going through these. So listen to it again. Does he actually do all three of them? Let me isolate just those. Here's what they would sound like if he did, after the diminished seventh, he did just the he did the double Lydian. There's one. Here's two. And then the third one would be. Changes it. Can you hear the difference?
Yeah.
You hear the difference? Because these things are also capable of surprise. This is how you pull off a surprise. So Beethoven's already, you're expecting him, you know, your ear is expecting him to finish this with the third one, and he's all of a sudden he's off somewhere else. Because he's ahead of you. He doesn't need to finish that. He's already made the point. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, the next part. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So now listen to the next part. I'm sorry. Let me do it again. The second part of the musical offering, after you get this, is this. A series of descending half steps. Now, do people know how Mozart uses that in the fantasy? No. Okay. What he does is revolutionary, because while he's playing, which is clearly based on the first part of the Bach, he's actually taken the half steps and put them into the pedal point series, which is another dimension, so that it's actually ordering all these strange keys that he's going through.
What do you mean, the downbeats over the first 10, 12 measures?
Yeah. Look, people
it's the left hand, it's in the bass, right?
It's in the bass, yeah. But you can experience, try singing with me, it helps. Just sing do, it's to maintain it. Series of half steps that Bach has in Musical Offering, only it's ordering, it's in the pedal point series, so you don't hear it as a theme, so-called. Mm. It's actually ordering it from outside of it in a certain way. You're aware of it, but you don't hear it as something that you can really sing.
Could you just play it again?
Sure. Try singing with me again.
No.
Goes all the way down to F sharp. He doesn't go down to G, the fifth. He goes down and he settles on F sharp, which is right here. So not only has he added these F sharp in the into the Bach in there, but he's also added into the pedal point series. And this is what Lynn always refers to as what's revolutionary about it. And the thing of Lynn's that made it most clear to me is when he said that Beethoven, that Mozart is taking the harmonic ordering of the human voice and imposing it on the formalist musical scale, thus generating all kinds of ironies and paradoxes. And that's really what it is, but it takes a long time to figure it out because it's not just looking in the notes. You have to get behind it.
He does the second Lydian also, right?
Yeah, he does all.
Not all three, but just the first two.
Yeah.
And he does the third one later.
Right. But then this section of the Beethoven, this part that goes. To just the bass line. So what is he doing? He's taking this upside down. But again, it's in the pedal point series, so you're not quite aware of it. So here he is, he's adopting everything that Bach and Mozart are looking at. And so what is the relationship of these 12 tones in an ascending scale to the Lydian interval? But he's doing it just by actually looking at singularities within the entire system without any predicates attached. So finally, he does come up with, well, let me just play it for you from here on in. And that's quite a buildup, isn't it? I mean,
he pulls out.
I mean, really, as Schiff points out, this is not a trill. It's written on the 32nd note. So he compares it to a timpanist, and it doesn't really speed up.
Are either bombastic or wimpy, one or the other. You know, bam, and then it sounds like, you know, Wagner, or it sounds like the person is completely limped out on the piece. Now, we did find one recording where the person managed to capture how to get the piece really shocked into action, and it's because he saw something which was not, which we hadn't actually seen before. And it might be useful just to play the beginning of that if you don't mind.
Yeah.
So people can hear.
Yeah. I thought you were asking me to do it.
No. It's very good. It's very good. But keep in mind, because, and this is where, Lynn, this is, I think, why Lynn, it's related.
Oh, sorry.
Well, yeah. Okay. Because remember, the reference to the Boccherini, which is this whole domain of how these trills function, but then also there's this flourish, which is totally diatonic. It's just an arpeggio.
Right.
In three times in the beginning, or I think it's twice. It's twice in the beginning. So the first two statements are triune. They each have three ironies, which is the intervals that Fred's been talking about, dissolving into a trill, which if you look at it the way Boccherini looks at a trill is an irony. That's what it is. And think of all the ways he's using this kind of trill-like expression, because you don't know which tone it is. That's why it's an irony. It's a very particular kind of irony. And then, which has this dissolving quality. And then this flourish where the tones are gone before you can, it's done
maestoso.
The whole thing is marked maestoso, which means majestically, but the flourish is in very, very quick notes. I mean, like 64th notes. So it's over before you have a chance to even think about it. So you have three ironies in each of the opening statements. The Lydians, the trill, and then this flourish. And we found a guy who really was struck by this. And you'll hear that what he does, if the speaker, that's why I was trying to get good speakers, if the speakers are any good, because what happens is he actually uses the pedal in such a way that the flourish sounds like a harp. So it really stands out as a completely different voice. It's really quite astonishing. And what this does is it creates three ambiguities, two changes. And it really sets you up for a very classical. The amazing thing is how classically rigorous this whole thing is.
Right, right.
Based on ambiguity.
Yeah, this is Friedrich Gulda doing it. And Rene is right. It's very hard to get somebody doing this right. They either are thundering around or they don't do it at all. And it is fast. These are 64th notes. Ba-bum. So it's not ba-dum the way that some people like to do it to make it seem more powerful.
Just watching, see.
iTunes cannot connect to the iTunes store, or whatever that is.
Oh, man.
There's a slider up there in the upper left hand.
There it is. Then let me point out a couple things. When he arrives at this, I mean, look, this is very unusual. It's in octaves at the bass. It's not up high, it's way down low. It's in octaves, it's unison or in octaves. So there's only one voice. And throughout a lot of this, there's only unison. There's only one voice. This in itself is also related to the musical offering and the Mozart. Can you hear them both in there? Just take the first two notes and the last one. Four. With either one of them, the first two notes and the last note. So to me, it brings back both. I hear them both in there. I hear not just Bach, but Mozart. And as Lynn put it, Mozart looking at Bach. So Beethoven is looking at the entire creative process. Plus also this interval. It's in there the other way around. But there's something else about it. Andrew Schiff said in his lecture, he compared it to Atlas holding up the world. And it has this quality. For one thing, there's all these sforzandos, and you could hear that Gulda was doing it, and Schiff does too. And he says people try to smooth it out, but they shouldn't. It's very rough, very rough. Schiff actually says your music teacher would tell you not to write like that. And it has that quality to it. I mean, Beethoven at this point is holding up the world. When everything's going down, he has to push things ahead. So the theme is very similar to this. The opening of Christ on the Mount of Olives, when Christ is praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, saying, Father, may not this cup pass from me. Am I the only person who's going to do this? All right? Plus, it was Alfred Brendel who pointed out, and I credit him for it, that Schubert has a song that goes like this. Compare that to the same intervals. It's the same, an upwards third and then a diminished fourth down. So it's the same intervals that he's working with. So it definitely is an association of this deep, of this idea with this Promethean titanic quality. And what I'd like to do is I pasted together excerpts of Schiff from his lecture to try and simulate a performance. Now you're going to have George is looking at me funny and saying, oh no. But yeah, it's got some skips in it and some repeated notes and him talking a little bit. But I wanted to give people an idea of what it would actually sound like with Schiff playing it. Because I think the Goulda thing I think is excellent, but I think this will be the best. And bear in mind that he's just doing this at a lecture, so it's not really, he hasn't really gotten it up to the standards for you.
Thank you.
When he comes back, the theme is now in four octaves instead of two. But also what's interesting is right before he comes back, the double Lydians from the opening are everywhere. Should we try and go into the second movement, or should we leave that for next week?
We probably should leave it, because you could play the, it takes 8 minutes to play the whole thing. Do people want to hear it from beginning to end?
Yeah, the Gula. That's a better idea.
Yeah,
sure.
Turn the computer down a little bit, and I can crank the speaker. It'll sound better.
Okay,
thanks. Make it sound clearer?
Yes.
Thank you.
Turn it way down.
Okay.
Yeah, well, Gould's is not, by the way.
No, that was really close.
Oh, that's good. I didn't know, there wasn't anything for that at that time. This guy's a little bit sharp. This guy plays a few of his tunes, which is unfortunate. This guy's a little bit crazy, but he's kind of a genius.
Unplug your power supply.
And a little bit softer, tiny bit softer.
Turn the.
Oh, yeah, get rid of that.
Who, are we listening to Gould?
Gould, yeah, just the first one.
Yeah.
Guy looks like a hippie.
Yes.
That's him.
Okay, here it goes. Oops, I got the wrong one.
Straight into the second movement.
That's great.
Okay, next week.